Hello and welcome out to this week's episode of Chatter With You Matter. This is our mental health podcast. And once again, before we get started, I just want to give a shout out to the Counseling Center here on campus, located in the fourth story of the Student Service Centers. And once again, their hours are every Monday through Friday from 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. They have same-day appointments where you can call in at 8 a.m. and schedule that. They also have scheduled appointments as well as crisis hours every day. And it is a free resource here on campus here at Chico State University. It is for the students, so please utilize that resource as much as you can. They are here for us. They want us to succeed, and they want us to be our best possible selves. So please check that out. And also, You Matter. We are also on all social medias. We are on Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, SoundCloud, Instagram. We also have our own website where we have a bunch of blogs and vlogs from our other interns. So go ahead and give us a like and give us a follow. Today's podcast is going to be a really fun episode. I'm very excited for it. Our topic today is going to be about sexuality. My name is Brandon Cross. I'm here once again, and I'm joined by my fellow intern.
Hi, guys. My name's Eve. I'm also a You Matter intern, and I'm really excited to talk about some sexuality stuff today.
Yeah. I mean, it's really a topic that kind of doesn't have as much of a spotlight on it as others once, but it's gotten more and more, I think, over time as a society. We're becoming more and more aware of the different, you know, mentalities and what exactly sexuality means.
Yeah, definitely. And sexuality, it is such a broad spectrum, and it's a very personal thing, and I think that's why it took such a long time for people to really, you know, have that conversation. And it's just more about, like, kind of understanding how we feel towards others. And it's not necessarily, like, who we choose to have sex with, which a lot of people think is what that means.
Yeah. And like you said earlier, it is a spectrum.
Yeah.
We now know that it's not just a homosexual or heterosexual thing, that it is a clear spectrum of so many different types of sexualities throughout. Yeah. And we're going to go over some terms today. We're going to talk about our own experiences, so we hope, you know, that you have a little more understanding by the time this episode's over.
Yeah, for sure. So like Cross was saying, you know, a lot of people think that you have to be on one end or the other of the spectrum, but sexuality, there's actually a lot of different things that someone can choose to identify with. So I have a few that are written down. There's a lot, but just some of the basic ones we'll go over.
Yeah, I don't think we'd have the time to be able to go over
So heterosexuality, which most of you guys will know, feeling sexual attraction to the opposite sex. Homosexuality, feeling attraction to the same sex. Bisexuality, sexual attraction to both males and females, which I will definitely talk more about, because I think out of a lot of the sexualities, bisexuals face a lot of stigma around that. Pansexual, experiencing attraction to all sexes and gender identities. Asexual, you don't experience sexual attraction to sex or gender, but an asexual person can experience romantic attraction. So yeah, that's like some of the more common ones that you'll see, but like I said, sexuality is such a broad spectrum. And I think the big issue with bisexuality is that people think that it's just not a real thing. Like I said, they think you have to be on either sides of the spectrum.
Yeah, that you either have to be heterosexual or homosexual, that there is no in between on it.
And especially if a bisexual person is dating someone of the opposite sex, people kind of just don't think that they can be bisexual.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, they just think that they are heterosexual.
Yeah, you're heterosexual. Yeah. But I heard, I heard a really good example of putting it in perspective. So, so basically this example is going to be using apples and bananas. And so lately scientists have been like researching more how our food preference is biological, right? And so like we're genetically inclined to like one food over another. And so basically like this ties into our like sexual preference or orientation. For example, someone that didn't like bananas, if they were asked to choose between apples and bananas, they would pick apples 99.99999% of the time. And vice versa, someone who didn't like apples would pick bananas 99.9999% of the time. And in that same way, for example, I would pick females over boys 99.9999% of the time.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there are girls that will pick boys 99.999% of the time.
Yeah.
And in science, like, those two ends of the spectrum are considered extreme, but there doesn't say anything that a person can't pick, like, a banana 60% of the time,
yeah,
and an apple 40% of the time.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, that concept almost seems, like, weird for people to understand. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I just think, I know, like, bisexuality kind of leans into the world of, like, sexual fluidity,
mm-hmm,
as well. But I just feel like, and we're going to go into sexual fluidity as well,
yeah,
but I just feel like bisexuality is just such an easier term for,
mm-hmm,
a lot of individuals to understand, especially those who really don't quite understand all the different, like, sides of sexuality,
yeah,
that bisexual is the one that just, it's easier to process.
Yeah. Yeah, no, definitely. And I think also, people think that if you identify as heterosexual and you are having feelings or just even a thought crosses your mind about the same sex, people feel the need to put a label on that and,
mm-hmm,
identify you as something, when sometimes those feelings are just feelings that come and go. It doesn't mean necessarily that, you know, you have to put a label on that.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's a really hard thing for people to kind of grasp.
Yeah, that you can just, like, see an individual and be like, oh, that's an attractive-looking individual,
yeah,
but then you cannot have, like, sexual,
yeah,
desires with them. You could just,
yeah,
be just attracted to the physical look of,
mm-hmm,
them.
Yeah, no, definitely.
So, and then I think that's, like, something that's, like, a common misconception about, like, sexuality, as you're talking about. Like, you can still identify and see a good-looking individual, regardless of sex or gender.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can still, like, you know, be sexually attracted to certain genders, but then,
yeah,
still acknowledge, like, hey, like, that's a decent-looking individual.
Yeah. No, definitely. And even, like, I see the struggle, actually, with a lot of people our age. If someone chooses to have relations with the same sex, they have this pressure to come to be identified as bisexual or whatever that might,
yeah,
be.
Yeah, to pick a side.
Yeah,
as you
pick
would
a
say.
Side. And sometimes, you know, people's sexual orientation is just what that means to them,
mm-hmm,
and how they choose to identify themselves. And I don't think that, you know, anyone else can really label that for them just because of actions that they did.
Yeah. And I think for so long why individuals have, like, that mentality when it comes to sexuality about needing to find something to identify with is just because society has this pressure of finding this little box,
yeah,
you might say, to, like, fit yourself,
yeah,
in. And so, like, everyone wants to put a label because everyone wants to put you in a comfortable little box that,
mm-hmm,
they can put you in. And,
yeah,
because anything outside of that is just always so scary and unknown,
yeah,
that I feel like society kind of pressures individuals to go that way.
Yeah. No, exactly. I totally agree with that.
And so there are, like, many, like, sexuality terms that, like, you briefly talked about at,
yeah,
the beginning. And, like, there's so many more, like, terms out there,
mm-hmm,
for people to identify. I know you talked about asexuality,
yeah,
which is just an individual who doesn't really experience any type of sexual desires with,
yeah,
anyone of any gender or anything.
Sex.
But, as you said earlier, that still does not mean that they can't have, like, romantic relations.
Yeah, I know.
With
they
people.
Definitely can still have that ability to experience romantic attraction,
mm-hmm,
which is really interesting for me. I don't know, like, too much about asexuality, but I find that really interesting.
Yeah.
And you can actually have, I just actually found this out today, there's such terms as heteroromantic, homoromantic,
mm-hmm,
biromantic, panromantic, aromantic. I actually didn't know about that.
Mm-hmm.
Did you?
We briefly talked about it in,
okay,
my sexuality,
okay,
course.
That's super cool.
Yeah, so, and, like, our professor was really good about, like, getting us to understand, like, you know, sex isn't just, like, the sexual attractions.
Yeah.
Like, you can still, like, have this feeling of love towards individuals,
yeah,
regardless.
Yeah, that desire for, like, a romantic relationship,
yeah,
but not, like, the sexual.
Yeah, aspect. Yeah, where,
yeah,
you know, you want to be with someone who cares about you, you,
yeah,
want to be with someone to care for, and you,
yeah,
want to be someone that can, like, comfort you and be there for you and vice versa, which is a relationship at all, but,
mm-hmm,
you can still not have the sexual desires there.
Yeah, yeah, definitely.
It does feel like we're gonna like repeat a lot throughout this episode, but that's just because like sexuality is such a complex topic that is just so broad that it's really hard to specifically hone in on one specific thing.
And there are so many different, you know, sexualities, and it kind of just takes time for people to figure out what's right for them. Mm-hmm. And I think, just a lot of
It took me like 22, 23 years before like I finally felt comfortable.
Yeah, I totally understand that. I feel like I still am figuring out stuff about my sexuality mm-hmm. every day, even as much thought as I've put into it.
And I feel like it's something we're going to continue to just learn about every day for mm-hmm. the rest of our lives. I feel like it just doesn't stop. It's just, you know, you trying to figure out and discover who you are.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. Do you want to talk a little bit about our personal experience?
Yeah, we can definitely get on to that. I mean, we talked about terms, you know, there's so many other terms. I highly recommend you, like, going, doing some research on it and just checking it out and kind of just, like, get a broader understanding of exactly mm-hmm. all the different ones. Do you want to go first, or?
I can start.
Okay.
Okay. So, for my own story, I personally, if I had to identify, put a label on myself now, I would identify as sexually fluid, mm-hmm. which basically, for those of you that don't know, just kind of means, you know, sometimes you can be more attracted to females, sometimes you can be more attracted to males, and it kind of just like switches back and forth. Mm-hmm. It's not necessarily bisexual because your preference changes over time and changes the amount of time mm-hmm. that you feel those things. But I started realizing that I was having feelings for the same sex when I was in high school, but I didn't really talk about it because, you know, it's not something that
you're in high school.
Yeah. And then, once I started dating girls my senior year of high school, there was this pressure to say, oh, you're a lesbian. You're mm-hmm. a lesbian. You like girls, you're a lesbian. And I was thinking, well, I don't really know if I'm done liking boys yet because, like, you know, you can't necessarily put a label on someone liking girls as lesbian.
Yeah, and especially at, like, such young age, it's, like, it's really hard to try and, like, tell yourself, like, oh, this is what it is.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. Like, high school is already a hard enough time with fitting in, so adding your sexuality into that was just very interesting. But over the years since then, since I came out as LGBTQ mm-hmm. in that community, I've been able to, like, realize more things I like and things I don't like and where I necessarily fit on the spectrum. Because I think when I first knew that I like girls, I thought what most people think, I have to be either on this end of the spectrum.
Yeah. You just figured that you have to fully commit to this.
Yeah, yeah. But it's, like, in reality, that's not how it works. Yeah. And, like, so now I identify as sexually fluid more than anything because I do have a preference for liking girls, the same sex, but I have had relationships with boys and I've enjoyed it, and I'm not necessarily looking for males right now, mm-hmm. but if one day, you know, a boy was to sweep me off my feet, I would be open to it because I'm just on the spectrum somewhere and I'm open to a lot of different things like male and female
mm-hmm.
preference.
Yeah. I know that, like, sexual fluidity is probably one of those terms that is probably the most, like, just off there. That's, mm-hmm. like, it can be quite difficult to understand exactly what it means.
Yeah.
With my sociology of sexuality course, when we were talking about all these different terms, and the professor came up and we were talking about it and just trying to figure out, like, how to describe it, you know, we say fluid and, you know, you just think of, like, a river flowing
mm-hmm.
within, you know, and then how, you know, the river just kind of goes along with it, like, it's not stopped by, like, a barrier that's in it. It just kind of just goes along with it, you know? It's not, like, in a set spot. It just flows along as the fluidity does.
Mm-hmm.
And one example that we read about in class, which I think was one of the best ways to describe it, is kind of looking at it kind of like shoe size. Okay. Whereas, you know, at one point in your life, you wore a size 5 shoe, but maybe you don't wear that anymore. Now you wear, like, a size 8, and that's what you currently are.
Mm-hmm.
But that still does not change the fact that you once wore a size 5 shoe.
Ah.
And that was just like one of the examples. Yeah, and I thought it was just like a really good way to try and like describe it. Like,
yeah,
just because your shoe size isn't what it used to be doesn't change the fact that it was that. And that it can still easily just as change as time goes on.
Yeah. That's interesting. I've never heard that.
Yeah, I didn't either. Yeah, and then when I heard about it, I was just like, wow, thank you. That was the best way
to put it. What I used to tell people, like, especially when I was first coming out and kind of realizing, like, you know, maybe I like girls, but maybe I still like boys. I don't really know. I used to tell people, because I get a lot the question, like, so are you bisexual? So are you lesbian?
Mm-hmm.
And I think, you know, it's a very hard question, so I'm surprised so many people have felt comfortable with just asking me.
Hmm. It goes back to wanting to put labels.
Yeah, exactly.
On it and just fitting in a box.
Yeah. And so I usually just tell people, you know, like, if I love someone, I love them for mm-hmm. them. And the gender aspect of them, like, will come after that. And I don't know how else to explain it to people. You know, that's the most simple way.
Yeah. But, like, it's never going to be simple.
Yeah.
We can try and explain and talk about these things as much as we can.
Yeah.
And there are just going to be some people who have no idea or understand how we're talking about it. But,
yeah.
You know, we should talk about these things. And we hope that it helps in any way, shape, or form.
Yeah. It's definitely always hard to understand things that you don't, you know, personally go through yourself. But.
Yeah. Because, like, for individuals who, like, you know, because we live in, like, this heteronormative culture that, you know, like, it's expected to be, like, heterosexual.
Yeah.
So, like, those people who are heterosexual just kind of have lived with the expectation their whole life. So they never really had to, like, bother to, like, try and figure things out for themselves.
Yeah, that's very true. Like, we grow up and immediately are assumed to be straight.
Yeah.
Heterosexual.
Yeah.
Like,
because we have to, it's a big deal when we come out and say that we're not, but if we don't say anything, it's the expected default, I suppose.
Yeah. I actually watched this video on YouTube. I don't know what it's called, but it shows a world in which being homosexual is the norm, and the little girl came out as straight, and it was just this big deal. Everyone at school is bullying her. Her parents, her two lesbian moms, like, disowned her. And it's just, when you watch it from that perspective, it just really makes you think, like, wow.
Yeah.
We really do have that, like, set in stone norm about heterosexuality.
Yeah, just kind of flipping the script on it.
Yeah.
But it's good to kind of, like, understand those things.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, yeah, we should kind of, like, pay attention to it a little bit more.
For sure.
Uh-huh.
Do you want to...
Yeah, I can go on mine. Mine's actually very recent about my sexuality, and I've talked to this with a couple people, not a lot, but I guess why not just share with it on everyone on this platform, you know? So within my sexuality course, when we were, like, going through all these different terms and kind of, like, looking at all these different ones and trying to understand them, there was this one term that came up. And it completely threw me off. And that term is demisexual.
Okay.
And so an individual who identifies as demisexual is someone who is only sexually attracted once, like, that emotional bond, like, has been created or made with an individual.
Okay.
And when I read this term and I read the examples of it and talking about it, it was, like, the biggest light bulb had,
really?
Like, ever gone off, like, in my head. Oh. Like, it just, reading about it, and then all of a sudden, just everything completely made sense to me about who I am and what I was. Because, not that, like, I'm against anything about it, the whole hookup culture and everything. Like, people are going to do what they're going to do. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, you go do, have your fun, just be safe. And there's nothing wrong with that. But to me, I just could never understand, like, the hookup culture behind it.
Yeah.
And, like, it just was such a bizarre, like, concept to me. And I had always felt like something was wrong with me for so long just because it was just something I could not, like, see myself doing.
Yeah.
And how, like, I just couldn't believe how easy a lot of people make it to be, especially being on a college campus.
Yeah.
To just have, like, those one-night stands and those hookups.
Yeah.
But then, you know, this term came up, and then all of a sudden it just made me, like, realize and understand, like, oh, like, this is more of who I am. Like, there is nothing wrong with how I am or
That's
my
so
sexuality.
Cool.
And, like, when I read about it and realized that, like, it was something for me, it just, it became like a very liberating type feeling, because like all of a sudden like all this pressure and like worries about like mm-hmm. myself and who I was just kind of all swept away.
Yeah.
And now like I have this term, demisexual. I'm still like straight.
Yeah.
But just like knowing that like, oh okay, that like I'm over here.
Oh my god, I'm so sorry.
Someone just walked in. All good. but just like having like just it does feel nice to have that label sometimes, because I just, yeah. like, I just didn't know for myself. Yeah. But then when this got term came up, it just, it was so freeing, and just, like, it helped me a lot with myself, just, like, understand me yeah. in a lot more way that I had never imagined before.
Wow. That's so cool.
Yeah.
And this is my first time hearing this also.
Yeah.
that is really cool that you were able to find that out about yourself. I mean, I can totally... like understand that feeling of just like, wow, like this is the word that I've been,
yeah,
this is what I've been missing.
Exactly. Wow, it felt so like awesome. A missing piece was just like finally,
yeah,
like put into play.
Well, I'm happy for you that you were able to like find that, and you know, it just takes that like weight off your shoulders.
Yeah, yeah. It
yeah.
like took 23 awesome. years, but
yeah. Just 23 years. That's awesome.
But no, and like I think like if I wasn't in this course, that like
yeah.
that term might have just avoided me almost my whole life.
That's very true.
And so just like having the opportunity to look into all these like different sexuality terms and mm-hmm. identifiers, just like
yeah.
it really helps a lot
mm-hmm.
when coming to like, you know, at peace with yourself and understanding yourself on a different level.
Yeah. Wow. Are you taking that class just for extra units right now?
Yeah, yeah. It's like sociology 1, I want to say 33, but I'm not 100% sure.
See, it's really cool that you're able to like take that, and like it's just weird how everything always like happens for a reason. Like maybe you weren't going to take that class.
Yeah.
I'm kind of getting off topic. but wow, that's really cool. That's really cool that you're able to realize that. And I actually don't know a lot of people who identify as that, so it's nice to like learn about it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and honestly, like, I don't know if I've ever met anyone like that. And maybe a lot of people are in the same position that I was in, where,
yeah.
like, that is how we would identify. We just
yeah.
are just unaware, that it
yeah.
exists out there.
And now that you do identify as it, you can find more people who also do, and then share your experiences or, you know, your thoughts, and that will definitely make you feel, you know, like you're not alone, because that's what people struggle with, I think, a lot with their sexuality. They don't want to feel, you know, out of the norm, or like they're the only ones who are feeling this way.
Yeah, yeah. And they also, like, I know, like, a lot of people within, like, the LGBTQ
mm-hmm.
are, like, very concerned if they, like, come out to their family.
Yeah.
They're so afraid that the support system might not be there for them.
Yeah.
When they do. So, in any, like, type of community, I figured the LGBT community has probably, like, been immensely, like, for you,
yeah.
just incredible.
Yeah, no, I've never really encountered any problems, actually, being in the LGBT community.
Mm-hmm.
It was definitely hard coming out to my parents. You know, I think that especially for the older generation, they just don't understand it as much as we do.
Yeah.
So that was definitely hard. But I've never experienced any problems with our peers, or
mm-hmm.
I think because everyone is, you know, being more accepting that people have these different feelings, and now becoming aware of, like, the feelings that you had, for example, now we are aware and we have terms for them, rather than when our parents were younger, no one really understood those
yeah.
types of things.
Yeah, and that's what I was, like, saying earlier. I think, you know, the older generation will be like, oh, there's too many terms, it's like,
yeah,
and everything, but it's not, like, about that. It's about just having a more of an understanding of it
yeah.
and realizing that it's not one or the other,
yeah.
that, as we said,
yeah.
it is a spectrum.
Yeah. And it takes time, like you said, 23 years.
It takes
yeah. time to figure that out. You can't, you know.
It's not
an
overnight
just
thing.
You know
yeah.
what you like with
yeah.
anything.
Yeah. You didn't just wake up one day and were like, oh, I want to get in a relationship with girls.
Yeah.
Like,
no, yeah.
It comes, like, over time, you know. It's
mm-hmm.
just part of the experience of growing older and
yeah.
kind of just trying to figure yourself out more and
yeah.
figuring out who you are.
And it is. It's a confusing thing, and
it still is.
Yeah,
as much as we talk about it, it still is.
Yeah, definitely.
But would you say, like, you know, your experience on college campus with, like, your sexuality has
mm-hmm.
been better as compared, you know, high school
I think,
or
yeah,
coming
actually,
out with your family?
I think college has been, the college atmosphere has definitely been the best place to be open about my sexuality.
Definitely.
In high school, like we were saying, people just, you know, were too young to understand. I didn't even understand really what was going on. And the only times I've gotten in some type of situation where I heard someone say something negative about it, that person is now gay. So, so yeah, I've never, it's definitely a lot easier in college. People are becoming more aware and more conscious of like how other people are feeling. And I feel like we get a lot of empathy by being in college and seeing a bunch of different people.
Yeah. Just so many different perspectives than just your hometown.
Yeah, definitely.
It definitely helps. Yeah, so we're about coming towards the end of our episode here. Do you have anything else you want to add to the conversation?
I touched on a lot of things that that I wanted to talk about, but
I'm surprised how much we got in this amount of time.
Yeah, but basically, if you are confused about your sexuality and you don't really know, you know, what label to put on it, the good thing is that you don't have to put a label on it. Just because, you know, other people do have a label and other people know what their sexuality is, people grow at different rates. And I still am figuring out what I like, you know? So,
yeah, okay, some people might figure out who they are when they're in elementary or middle school. Yeah. Where, you know, for someone like me, like, it took me 20 years to.
That's true, because I've heard people that have known since they were, like, 5 years old.
Yeah.
And I didn't know. I say I was at that age, but I didn't know until I was way older. Uh-huh. So everyone does that at different speeds.
Yeah, everyone grows at different rates.
Yeah.
And, like, there is nothing wrong about any way that, like, you identify or, you know, your sexual attractiveness. It's just, like, there's so many different levels of it. You know, we talked about romantic, like, relationship or sexual relationship. Like, they're so different. But, you know, like, it's who we are.
Yeah. Yeah. Definitely.
Thank you so much for being here today.
Yeah, thank you for having me.
Yeah. I had a lot of fun with this episode. Yeah. Before we sign off, once again, I just want to give a plug to the Counseling Center here on campus. They are located on the fourth story of the Student Service Center, and their hours are every Monday through Friday, 8 a.m., to 4 p.m. They have same-day appointments, scheduled appointments, as well as crisis hours. And once again, it is a free resource for students on campus. So please utilize it, use it. They are here for us. And don't forget to give us a follow and like on all of our social medias. Once again, You Matter Chico State. We are on Twitter, Facebook, SoundCloud, YouTube, Instagram, as well as our websites with a lot of blogs and vlogs from other interns. So
they're really cool. Check them out.
Yeah. And also every Monday at 2 p.m., we have Eve actually here, as well as other intern hosting an hour with the school radio station, KCSC Radio, for Mental Health Hour, 2 p.m. on Mondays.
Yeah.
So go and check Eve out. She's really awesome with it, her and Jimmy. They do a lot of really good stuff over there, so
we have some good talks, play some good music.
Yeah, so
check it out.
Give it a listen too. So thank you so much for listening in on today about our podcast on sexuality, and I hope you have a great rest of your day.